Jesus é o Senhor. Contentes, desfrutando,
enjoying,
na vida,
in life.
Graças ao Senhor por mais
essa
conferência.
Lord for one more conference.
Nós vamos hoje ter a nossa última comunhão.
This is our last fellowship.
Mas não vamos encarar isso aqui como fim de festa.
Let us not face this as the end of a party, okay?
Nós continuamos
We continue enjoying the Lord, enjoying the Word, and the Lord has still many things for us. What is the general subject of this conference? Guide me, lead me, O Lord, in your way. So we began, we saw that the Lord has an identity for us. We are someone with a vision, facing many difficulties, but we overcome them. And we have seen the character of Joseph, that many of the experiences he went through are the same as ours, and just as he overcame them, we can also do, and we hope this last message, we also see some other practical things about our experience with the Lord in our daily life. So the title of this last message is A Young One Who Is Useful and Reigns, which was the result, the closing in Joseph's life. So we'll share in two parts, one in being useful and one part in reigning. So let us speak about being useful. What is something useful which serves for a purpose? That's right. You serve for something. Yours. Which is useless. Think a little bit. Do you have anything that is useless? Is good for nothing? Is it worth it to have things that are good for nothing? Would you use your money to buy things that are good for nothing? Yes or no? Let us say that if you work and you strive, you make money, and with that money you want to buy something, would you buy something that would be not good for you? How about a large shoe on sale? With a discount, 70% off. 70% off, it's a very good discount. But it's a large size, it doesn't fit you. It's the last one in the store. Would you buy it just because it's a great discount? So, being useful, it's important. So let's see if this works. It seems it's not working, so let us go to next picture. How about next? Would you use your money to buy a monocle? You know that glasses are always plural, right? But just for those of you who are not very good with grammar, glasses are plural. Never say in singular. It's a pair of glasses because they have two eyes. So if you have only one eye, if you're one-eyed in the center of your forehead, you can buy a monocle. How about that? Would you use your money to buy something like this? Would that be useful for you? Yes or no? No. So then let's see one more example. How about this thing? You fill it up and you don't know what you do with it, right? Next. This one is great. Right? Sometimes you have to do a lot of strength, but if you connect to a plug, you can be shocked. For example, one more. Next. Oh, this one is important. Because sometimes you know you are to drink more than one cup, so you fill up both already. So you take one and then the other one. You don't need to go back to fill up a second glass. So on top of that, to fill up this one, you can use a jar like this. It is very practical, isn't it? One more. Oh, this one is great. Because sometimes you keep your cup and then you have a problem with the wing, and then, but if it's inside, then you have no room. So, right? It's a very good idea, isn't it? It's very useful. Next. How about this one? Okay. Or that was an amazing idea. One more. Then you don't know exactly what is useless, if it's the stairs or the door. One more. Oh, this one is good. You use your umbrella, but your feet always gets wet, right? Your umbrella cannot protect your feet. But now you can work that out. You can solve that problem, right? Okay. How about you? Are you useful? Or you are like one of those objects that we just showed you, or as they say, or you are good for nothing. So think about it. Are you useful or not? So we are all useful, right? For something, we are good. Are you useful for something, or do you consider yourself a useless person, good for nothing? Do you consider it that way or not? It is the way you were introduced. Oh, this is my friend. He's good for nothing. Oh, I've met a very interesting person. She's good for nothing. Is that the way it is? We are all useful for something we are good for. The question is, what for? What is our usefulness? Why are we useful for? We're speaking of a useful young one. We have hundreds of young people here. And I'd like to believe that all of you are useful, right or not? Yes, you are useful, but the question that you must ask and respond is, I am useful for what? What am I good for? What is my function, my role, what is my usefulness? More than that, I'm useful to whom? There are some things that are useful for those who need it. The first picture we saw of a monocle. A few people, they need glasses. They need to wear glasses, in plural. Right? If I do not need glasses, will they be useful for me? No, but for those who need them, it will. So, besides of asking if you're useful or not, you should ask yourself, to whom am I useful? Who needs me? And if they need me, am I being useful or not? Because one thing is someone do not need you. Another thing is someone needs you, but you're not willing to be useful to that person. We are seeing in these days Joseph's life, right? So let us turn to the next slide. Joseph was useful. Do you agree or not? The first person he was useful for was whom? His father. So let us read a few verses. In Genesis 37, Genesis 37:2. This is the history of Jacob. This is interesting, right? This is the history of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brothers. And the lad was with the sons of Bela and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought a bad report of them to his father. In verse 12, we read, then his brothers went to feed their father's flock in Shechem. And Israel said to Joseph, are not your brothers feeding the flock in Shechem? Come, I will send you to them. What did Joseph say? So he said to him, here I am. In other words, okay, I'm on it. Okay? How many times? I know, you usually don't say like that, right, dear father? So here I am. But how many times your father or mother asks you something and you say to them, ready, I'm ready, I'll do it. Or they ask you something and then you say, oh my, now. I'll do it later. Of course, you never say that, right? You don't say it, I'll do it later. Not now. Later. Tomorrow. Yeah, I'll be right there. I'll be right there. You notice that? I'll be right there means later, afterwards, right? I'm coming. What does that mean, I'm coming? Wait for it. Right? But when Joseph's father asked him, he said to him, here I am. And then we continue on verse 14. Then he said to him, please go and see if it is well with your brothers and well with the flock, and bring back word to me. So he sent him out of the valley of Hebron. He went to Shechem. Now a certain man found him, and there he was wandering in the field. And the man asked him, saying, what are you seeking? He said, I'm seeking my brothers. Please tell me where they are feeding their flocks. And the man said, they have departed from here, for I heard them say, let us go to Dothan. So Joseph went after his brothers. He returned home. Is that what we read here? No. So his father sent him to Shechem. He got there. His brothers were not there. So what would you do? How many times your mother asked you, okay, go to your room on the bed, there's this thing, and then take it for me. Then you go, look on the bed, it's not there. What do you do? Mom, it's not here. Right? Especially men. Men are just like that. Women still look around, but men, it's a serious matter. Right or not? Where is this thing? Oh, it's in the locker there, and then you open it up, and... Oh, it's not here. Right or not? It's amazing. He's very loyal. If it's to look at the closet, he just look at the closet. He's not curious enough to look around. But Joseph was not like that. He went after they were supposed to be. They were not there. What did he do? He went and continued looking for them. Why? Because he wanted to be useful. Would he be useful to his father if he just returned home and said, Father, I was there the way you asked, and they were not there? But let me ask you, how many times we just do the minimum when it's interesting to us, right? Because if anyone tells you, I have a gift for you, it's in the closet, there in the kitchen. And you go to the closet, you open it up, it's not there, what do you do? You just, you know, turn everything upside down, you look around the whole thing, you go to the next room, toilets, everywhere in the house till you find what is interesting to you. So then you realize that being useful many times depends on my what? My interest. If I'm interested in to be useful, then I'm very useful to my father or for my mother. Oh, my mother said that she had a chocolate box for me, and then I went after it and was not there, but, you know, I was very diligent looking all the way around, you know, to obey my mom. Right or not? So, many times, our usefulness depends on our interest. It's not others' interest who needs us. When someone else's interest matches my interest, then I do it. Right or not? But if what he wants is different from what I want, then it's a different story. This was not Joseph's case. He was useful because he thought on the needs of his father. His father needed news from his brothers. Joseph, maybe he did not care about what was going on with his brothers. Remember, they hated him. Oh, here comes the dreamer. So then Joseph was worried about what they felt. about his interest or he would do well or not. No, he was concerned about being useful to his father. So here we have two characteristics of Joseph. First, he was obedient. Second, he was diligent. So these two traits, those are two traits of someone who wants to be useful. Do you want to be useful? To whom do you want to be useful? Because you may be useful to your own desires, to your own will. Maybe if you are to read a book to do your homework, then you read a little bit today, a little bit tomorrow, and you have no more time. Oh, I don't have time. Or then to read the Bible. In the beginning of the year, it's the beginning of reading the Bible, right or not? Did anyone begin reading the Bible this year? That's right. Okay, if you noticed how difficult it is to find time to read the Bible, it is amazing. Oh, it's really hard. But I watch soap opera, and the soap opera is on TV every day. Then I get time to watch TV, right? I find time. If I have to do my homework or to watch TV, soap opera that will be disclosing who's who, then I find a way. Either I just pass my homework or before, but during the soap opera, what do? I just set that time for the soap opera. Why? Because I'm interested. So our usefulness depends on our interest. So, to whom do we want to be useful? To whom did Joseph want to be useful? First, to his father. This put him in a great trouble because of that. His brothers dumped him in a pit and they sold him to Egypt. So, he was just getting into trouble by being obedient and diligent. It would be better for him if he returned home and said, okay, I went there, they were not there, so I don't know what to do. Isn't that the case? Many times when we speak to people and when they ask us anything, think a little bit about it. So in this conference today, we don't need to go farther. Today, what are the things that you are not doing because they were not your own interest? You know, that you should have done or could have done would be useful to someone, but you were not interested in doing so. Did you set your bed today? Did you help cleaning today, your dormitory? When you pass by the cafeteria and then you see napkins on the ground, do you catch them? Do you take them? Do you put the garbage in the right place? Caring for cleaning may not be useful for you, but will be useful to all those around you. Maybe you are not, you don't care about it, but it is good for everyone. The question is, are you interested in being useful to everyone in this way? Now, if for each napkin that you take and you put in a garbage can, and then you make 10 reais, for each, then you'll be the tiniest and cleanest person ever in Estância. You'll be looking around papers to take them, right? or not. See? So, we can be useful when we want to, when we are interested. But we have here a model of someone who was useful, even when if it was not his interest. This, young people, this is the picture, this is the model that we need to pursue. We want, remember, Joseph had a dream that one day he would do what? To reign. Right? He would be sitting on the throne. He would order and people obey him. Right? Isn't that what someone who reigns does? That's eventually what happened. He ordered and people obeyed him. But until he got there to fulfilling his dream, it's been 13 years. Who is 13 here? Was your whole life. Why? Because he was sold when he was 17. He had dreams. I mean, he had dreams when he was 17. That's what we just read. But then, how old was he when he became governor in Egypt? He was 30 years. So tell me the truth. Do you think someone who's 30 an old man? Is it or not? When I was 17, someone who was 30 for me was an old man. Right? Today, for me it's a child, but at that age, it was an old man. How old is he? Oh, I don't know. Maybe your age? Oh, maybe he's old. 30 years. Right or not? So, much time passed by from the time he had a dream to the time the dream was fulfilled. What did he do in the meantime? He just crossed his arms and waited? No, he acted. He was useful. So let me share something to you, and I hope you keep this. The Lord gives us dreams. The Lord gives us visions. And the Lord will fulfill them. And we believe that. But will not be quick. So then, what will be my attitude till my dream comes true? Will I cross my arm and wait, or will I be useful? He was diligent. This is a characteristics of someone who will be reigning. Saints, young ones, this is God's desire for you. He wants you to reign. It's not just one day, it's now. You know what happened? Joseph had this attitude the whole time. Let us still see Genesis 39. Look at this. He was sold as a slave, right? Does a slave reign? No. Did that have anything to do with his dream? No. It seemed that the more time passed by, the more distant he was from the dream he had, right? But look at his attitude. Verse 2. The Lord was with Joseph, and he was a successful man. He was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. So, was he at home? No. He was in the house of his master, and he was a slave. Let me tell you something. At home, Joseph was the daddy's sugar, right? The daddy gave him things that he didn't give to others. We may say that he was pampered. Do you know anyone who was pampered beside yourself? Is it nice to be around someone who is a pampered? Is it or not? No, I don't want it. I don't like it. Oh, no. Tell the truth. It's the dream Everyone's dream to have someone who's pampered around you, right? It's everyone's dreams to be around someone who's pampered, right? Tell me the truth. Are you not dreaming of having someone who is pampered, Iago? I'm sure this is your dream, right? This is your life's desire. You would do everything for a pampered kid. You already have one. So you see, not everyone is a lucky man like you. So what should I do? So he was at home, and his father was wealthy with many employees, servants, who could do many things, but he was diligent. So when he left home, look at verse 3. Potiphar, and his master saw the Lord was with him, and that the Lord made all he did to prosper in his hands. So Joseph found favor in his sight. He found favor before him. And served him. Then he made him overseer of his house, and all that he had he put under his authority. So it was from the time that he had made him overseer of his house and all that he had that the Lord blessed Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. And the blessing of the Lord was on all that he had in the house and in the field. Potiphar, all that he had he entrusted to Joseph's hands. In a way, thus he left all that he had in Joseph's hand, and he didn't know what he had except for the bread which he ate. So his only concern was if he was going to eat or not, because apart from that, he knew that Joseph was taking care of it. So he was caring for the field, the cattle, the house, cleaning everything. So how old was he back then? Maybe he was 18. Let us say he was there for a year. So, even though he was a pampered kid, a spoiled kid, he was not crossed arms waiting for other people doing things for him. How about you? What is your situation? At home, are you waiting for others to do things for you? He left home when he was 17. And this conference, the age goes from 11 through 17, right? So he was like you. Today, a young one who is 17 many times has to leave home to study, right? He finishes high school and he's around 17. And then he goes to college. Sometimes he is approved in another city, and he lives outside of his home. He cannot even boil the water to prepare coffee for him, right? He can do nothing. He will live outside. He cannot understand why at his home have dust the whole day. Every day, because in his home did not have. Well, something is wrong with this new house, right? In this new house he's living, dirty clothes are still dirty. Because in his home, he put off his clothes, left in the corner, and then on the next day would be clean and ready in a drawer. Was amazing. But in his new home, he's alone. That doesn't happen. Something is wrong with the house. Right or not? So, they realize how Joseph's life has everything to do with their life. What is your attitude? After a while, maybe you will leave home. How will you be reacting? the way you already do today. Things doesn't change overnight just because you left home. You learn quicker, but you suffer a lot. So, what we want to say, young ones, adolescents, is that you have the opportunity to be trained, to be useful today. Where are you? Where you are? Do not wait later. You can be useful today. But to whom? You can be useful to God. You can be useful to your parents. But you know what else? You can be useful for the devil. Much useful for the devil. Actually, we have in us a strong desire to be useful to the devil, doing things of our flesh. And we are useful to him many times a day. When we feed our thoughts with anger, hatred, with ideas, evil ideas, when we fill our mind with sexy thoughts, when we see porn, these things make us extremely useful to the devil. So, saints, we are all useful, always. The question is, to whom? Think a little bit. To whom are you useful? To whom are you being useful? Even today, here in this conference, maybe you already had this experience today. You were quite useful for the devil with your thoughts, in your behavior, in words you said. When you looked at someone in a certain way, you were being quite useful for the devil. Do you realize that? You don't need to wait on that day. Today, the Lord is already working in you. Let us continue. Verses 21 through 23. But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy, and he gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. And the keeper of the prison committed to Joseph's hands all the prisoners who were in the prison. Whatever they did there, it was his doing. What do they do in jail besides of throwing burning mattresses? We just damage walls, paint walls, destroy everything. That's right. All prisoners are great engineers in building tunnels, right? They never studied engineering, but they learned to do that, and many other things. Joseph was imprisoned unjustly. What he could do? Okay, what am I doing here? Okay, it's not my fault that I'm here, so I will do nothing. But what did he do? He tried to be useful. He was there. He could just wait. This is what I want to show to you. Until his dream was fulfilled, will take a while, will take long. So, but do not think that you don't have nothing to do in the meantime. You have a lot to do, and whatever you do will influence in the way and the time of your dream coming true or not. So, in verse 23, Genesis 39:23, we read, the keeper of the prison did not look into anything that was under Joseph's authority, because the Lord was with him, and whatever he did, the Lord made it prosper. That is, the Lord, whatever he did worked out. Why? Because first, the Lord was with him. Second, he was obedient and diligent. So let us see the next two slides. He was useful also to Potiphar, and he was also useful to the jailer. So besides that, next slide, he was also useful to the whole world. Let us read Genesis 41. Verses 56 and 57. The famine was over all the face of the earth. Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold to the Egyptians. And the famine became severe in the land of Egypt. So all countries came to Joseph in Egypt to buy grain. They came to Joseph, because the famine was severe in all lands. So here, his dream was fulfilled. That was why that we may say he was born. Joseph was born for that. The Lord gave this dream to him. He was very much important to preserve life of everybody else. But he was not arms crossed, waiting, oh, when will I rain? It's taking too long. Let me sleep while in the meantime. So let me watch TV. Or let me just watch, play games while in the meantime. Or I'll do just nothing, because after all, I was raised to reign. This was not his behavior, because he was diligent in every small situation, and in minor things were heading to, he got there. So what we want to say to you is that your life is no different. Sometimes you say, oh no, Joseph was perfect, he did everything right. No, Joseph was a man just like you and me. He had choices to make. He could have chosen not to obey his father, right or not? That would not be good, but he could do that. But he chose to obey. He could have chosen to be a mediocre slave, just to do whatever his master ordered, but then he was put to care for more things. He could be an ordinary prisoner, just concerned about building tunnels and fleeing, escaping, breaking out, burning mattresses, but what did he do? He cared for others. So in all that, Joseph was useful. The question still remains the same. How about you? How about you? What is your usefulness whatever you are? And to whom? Think a little bit. What is usefulness in school for the Lord? Now think a little bit about it. Close your eyes and bow your heads and pray to the Lord. Lord, what is my usefulness in school? And to whom am I being useful? In the second part of the second section of this message, let us see the second part. He was useful and he also reigned So first thing, Joseph reigned over slavery. Was he a slave? He was. But he was reigning there. Was he acting as a slave? Think a little bit. Caring for all things of his master. His master only cared for one thing, if he had food on the table or not. He did not care about his fields producing, if the house was clean, if everything was in order. Who was in charge of the house? Who was in charge of the house? Joseph was. Who, the house belonged to whom? His master. He was a slave. But was he acting as a slave? No. He was acting as the owner. He took very good care of the thing that he was acting as the master. So he reigned on that place. So this much way before his dream came through. This is what we want to share with you. From here to the time your dream is fulfilled, till the Lord comes, will take a long time. We don't know how much time. Maybe it will take long that we will not survive. You may die before that. But the question is, will you wait to reign only on that day, or will you reign today? Will you reign today? Will you govern today? Or will you be governed? You can be governed by your laziness. You can be governed by television. How many times you wanted to turn it off, but you were not able? How many times you thought it was time to stop watching, but you couldn't? Who was reigning there? Well, it was you or the TV. You were raised to govern, to reign. You were called to reign, but who was really reigning? Who was really reigning your day today? Joseph also reigned over temptations. When Potiphar's woman tempted him, it was not just once. It was many times, and that's the way the devil do to us. Temptations do not come just at once. It always comes, the whole time. Let us look here in Genesis 39, verses 9. From verse 7, okay? It came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast longing eyes on Joseph, and she said, "Lie with me." But he refused and said to his master's wife, "Look, my master does not know what is with me in the house. He has committed all that he has to my hand." So look what Joseph responded to her. "There is no one greater in this house than I." So Joseph was greater than Potiphar in that house. He could do everything, anything. He could lie with that woman. Could he or not? If he wanted to, he could. That's how things happen. When temptations come, they offer to us that we can do. But if we do it well, no one finds out. That's why we have a secret life many times, a double life. Alone, we are one thing. With others, we are another person. And then the secret life may begin to grow. Grow, and take over us, and then one time we can no longer hide. But Joseph governed this will. He was a young man. And Potiphar's woman, maybe she was really good looking, wasn't it? But he governed over the situation. He was not governed by it. But many times we are governed by our desires, by our wills. Here we continue. So, what happened about this time when Joseph went into the house? None of the men was inside, that she caught him by his garment, saying, "Lie with me." But he left his garment in her hand and fled and ran outside. So he ran away. This is the attitude of a king or not. Think a little. Is it the attitude of someone who is reigning or not? We must remember 2 Timothy 2:22. Maybe you get up. Maybe you wake up. Let us read together. How about if we stand up? Let's wake up, open our eyes, and get up and stand up. Let's go. Everyone together. Flee also youthful lusts, but pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Again, flee also youthful lusts, but pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. This is the attitude of someone who reigns. You may be seated. This is the attitude of someone who reigns over his own wills, over temptations, over sin. He ran away. To run away, to flee, is not an attitude of a coward. It's someone who reigns over temptations. We cannot face temptations. We must run away. Here, let us turn to Genesis. Joseph knew it. And in verse 9, after he said he was not greater than Potiphar, he said, 42:9. And Joseph, 39, verse 9. He said, "There is no one greater in the house than I." So then he was reigning over the temptation. Who was the greatest picture in prison? Was the jailer, but he was on vacation. And he left all the prisoners in Joseph's charge. So who was really reigning there? He was. He was king. No, he was a prisoner. Was he seen as a king? No, he was seen as a common, an ordinary prisoner. But what was his real position? What was his real function? He was reigning. Today, young ones, this must be clear to us all. Today, people don't see us as overcoming Christians, but we can have an attitude like that, a behavior like that in school. Who is reigning? Is the world reigning or you reigning? Who's governing your will? Who's governing your attitudes, your behaviors? Who's governing your eyes? What are you watching? What are you seeing? What are you doing? And eventually, he reigned over all lands. Let us read chapter 41, verses 40 onward. Let us see what Pharaoh said to him. You shall be over my house, and all my people shall be ruled according to your word. Only in regard to the throne will I be greater than you. And Pharaoh said to Joseph, see, I have set you over all the land of Egypt. Then Pharaoh took his signet ring off his hand and put it on Joseph's hand. And he clothed him in garments of fine linen and put a gold chain around his neck. And he had him ride on the second chariot which he had, and they cried out before him, bow the knee. So he set him over all the land of Egypt. Pharaoh also said to Joseph, I am Pharaoh, and without your consent, no man may lift his hand or foot in all the land of Egypt. Here was the fulfillment of his dream. But he did not wait 13 years to have an attitude of reigning over situations. Today, you are 11, 12, 13, up to 17, all the participants here in this conference. What is your attitude in regards to sin, in regards to temptations, in regards to when your parents ask you anything, or whenever a brother or sister asks you anything, when your monitors asks you anything? Who is governing your timing, your time, TV or yourself? Who is governing what you're watching, what you are seeing, what you're reading? Look at this. They just released the book, The Gospel, The Power of God Unto My Salvation. Do you remember that or not? Was youth conference in January last year. It's been 1 year that we were sharing these messages here. Now it was released in book format, and you're still on vacation. You have time, so what you're going to do with your time? Are you going to govern your time, or your time will govern you? So you have a great opportunity here to reign. Reading and enjoying the Word. This is a choice that you have to make. All those things are choices. Joseph had to make many choices. Of course, in some of them he had no choice, but in others he had. And you certainly have many opportunities to choose. What will be your choice? What are you going to choose to do? What will you choose to read? What will you choose to watch? What will you choose to listen? Who are you going to choose to stay? Where are you going to choose to use your time? With the young people, with young friends, alone, the whole time we're making choices, and our choices define who we are. Joseph, when he was 30, was the result of all the choices he made over the course of his time. Today, for 14, you already have many choices to make. This will define who you are. From six years from now, when you're 20, you'll be the result of your choices from today until then. The whole time, we have to make choices. And many times, we make wrong choices. I made many wrong choices in life, many times. But the Lord was merciful to me. And I had the church life. Thank the Lord. I came to the church life when I was 17. And I had brothers that I could go after and talk to them. Anytime that I wanted to do anything on my own, I would just be in a bad situation. But when I went after the saints, I had help, I had support. You today have a great opportunity. The church life is a wonderful life with wonderful people. Sometimes they're so annoying. They really breathe down our neck. They're wonderful anyway, but we don't see that. They help us to make choices, to make decisions, to follow through the path, and then we will go step by step. When we look back, and we see all the choices we made, all the choices, the ways we followed. It made us to reach where we are today. So, pay attention to this. Today, it is always the result of what is past. You cannot change what passed by, but you can change my attitude today onward. We'll have baptism in a moment, a new beginning for many people. What is past will be buried. Will not be buried on the ground, will be in water, actually. Will not be buried on the ground, will be buried on the water, in the water. You'll have a new opportunity, a new beginning. So we need to remember what Paul said, forgetting the things past. We're not there yet. But one thing we do. What do? We press on. We'll go forward. Now, you came this far, in this point. Today, you are the result of all the choices and decisions of your past. But now you have a new opportunity to make a new choice, to make a new decision, to have a new beginning. How about if we take that opportunity to have a new beginning? Amen. How about if we stand up and let's pray? Let us pray for this new beginning. Let us seriously go before the Lord and say, Lord, I made many decisions in the past that were not the best ones. I did not use my time well. I did not use my eyes well, my ears well, but my friendships well, the opportunities you gave me, Lord, this moment, I repent. I want to have a new beginning with you. Let us use 1 minute to have an individual prayer with the Lord about all that we did so far and how we will move from this time onward. Amen. Let us pray. You gave me a vision, a dream, and you put in the church life the best place in the universe. Thank you, Lord. Forgive me for my bad choices, my bad decisions. I want to have a new beginning this morning. I want to take you, Lord, as my vision. To take your dream as my dream. I want to reign over my will, over my laziness, to reign over my time. Oh, Lord Jesus, teach me, Lord. I don't know what to do. Teach me, Lord. Also, I want to open more to the saints, to be opened to those around me. Thank you for the church life. Thank you for the saints who are serving the young ones and the adolescents. Thank you for the monitors, for the young people's conference. Lord Jesus, oh, what a privilege. Teach me, Lord, from now, to be useful to you, whatever I am, not be waiting to be useful later, but to be useful today, to be useful in the church life, to be useful in school, to be useful at home, to be useful to you, not to the devil. Forgive me, Lord, for being so useful to the devil in the past. But I repent. I turn to you. I want to be useful to you only. Oh, Lord Jesus. Oh, Lord Jesus. Give me a new beginning, Lord. I need you, Lord. Oh, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.